tonight I've been saddled with the responsibility to talk to us about the good news. That's going to be our Bible study and our series that we have for the next few weeks. We're living in a wonderful and divine time. It's a holy a time. And the reason I say that, it's in the darkness that some of God's greatest work is seen and done. We know that the Lord is on our side. So when things look dismal and things don't seem to be going right, it's really a good time. We know that the Lord is on our side. This is a good time when we need to seek the Lord and His righteousness. This is the time we need to ask of Him, knock, and expect the door to be open. We are to look for greater things to be occurring, expecting victory over every challenge that comes in our life. Therefore, I asked us not to miss the opportunity that we are living in right now and seize every moment. Let us prepare and get ready for greater. I believe John Eves have been ministering to us about elevation and the power of our faith, and we definitely want to make sure we tap into that. It's the trying of our faith that work in patience. So we need to let patience have its perfect work. If we suffer with Christ, we also shall reign with Him. Understand that when we suffer with Christ, for me, it is we have this word of God within us, and we know God's promises. We know what God has said. If we suffer, going through, knowing, not giving, not yielding, just being determined to press forward, that's what the suffering is all about. Suffering with Christ is knowing and believing the promises that God made. Even though it don't look well, we got to wrestle with this thing and keep the faith to be determined about it. Suffering is having the word of God in us. It's hid in our hearts. We are going to fight the good fight for faith. So that's the suffering, again, that we have. We're living in a time when we must be creative. We got to think outside of the box because we have to do things a little bit different than we have been done, that has been done in the past. It challenges us to be more creative, to be more like God who created us. There is nothing, we got this word, there is nothing too hard for God. This is the good news that we have. All things work together for the believer. All things work together for the good to those who are called by God and who are called according to His purpose. So this series is about the good news. It is to inspire us, to give us hope, have an expectation in our minds and our soul and our spirit as we look forth and renew our minds, refresh our soul, and be convicted and make up our mind that what God has promised us, it shall come to pass. Over the past few months, I am sure that you have listened to the wisdom and advice coming from leaders and experts around the country, from every institution of life. We've heard from doctors, legal experts, business leaders, educators, politicians, leaders in the faith community, parents, and many others sharing from their wealth of knowledge and experience regarding the crisis that is plaguing the world. They're sharing to the best of their ability the information they have gained from being taught in school and doing research and also going through it through life, just the ups and downs. But this information still have not brought answers. But we do know that there's one who holds the answers, and this is why we need to fall on our knees and seek the Lord while He may be found and call upon Him, that He may show us the way and show us what we need to do. As I listen to the cries and the complaints of people and watch many individuals ignore information on best practices and doing as they please, I wonder how many of these individuals have consulted God for wisdom and direction. I wonder if what these persons are sharing is grace with the wisdom of God, or is this just coming out of their own ability and their own assumption that they know. I wonder if they are trying to accomplish the things of God, or if they're trying to be self-serving and accomplishing things of themselves. Are we taking full advantage of the time in which we're in right now? And I'm talking about following God's direction, trying to gain some knowledge and truth from Him, or are we trying to function out of our own personality to gain something or to take advantage of someone or something else that's going on? So I wonder if people are looking to going back. I hear that a lot. I can't wait to go back to vacation, going out to dine and going out to eat and going to, out to do different things. I'm not too sure if that's the mindset that we should take. Why go back? We know what's behind us. Why not seek to move forward into greater and more meaningful things that perhaps God has given us an opportunity to seek Him about and to see where He's trying to lead us? Are we seeking to go back to the minor things amidst the major things that God's trying to show us? So the good news is the Word of God that we have. It comes from the word good news is really the gospel of Jesus Christ. It comes from the gospel, an old English word meaning good. And this word that means good, when you're talking about news, it's a story. This good story, this new story that we have, is the good news of Jesus Christ, His birth, His ministry, His death, His purpose, and His resurrection. Jesus came to this realm, to the earth realm, on purpose, for purpose, ministered on purpose, and died with purpose, rose again from the grave. And with this grace and this purpose that He has given unto us, this is the good news that we have. We are not like the world who have no hope and is challenged with some things in life and act as if there is not a God. This is the good news. The gospel is the good news, is what we are commanded to preach and teach. The gospel, the good news, is what we was drawn to God by, the preaching of the word, what we heard, and we mixed it with faith and we believe in what we heard. The good news, the gospel, give us power, it reinforces us and give us hope. Listen to this. When it comes to the kingdom of God and His righteousness, there is good news in darkness. When it comes down to what God is doing and how God function and do things in our life, there are blessings and burdens. There is hope existing for us in times of despair. A way can be made where there appeared to be no way. When we're talking about with God and the things of God, we know no weapon formed against us shall prosper. We are more than conquerors through Him who loves us. This is that word that we should have in us that empower us and give us faith to hold on and fight that good fight of faith that when challenging time comes, it makes a difference. So we're going to look at a few scriptures here and share a few thoughts. I'm not trying to preach. I'm not trying to give you a spin on anything. I pray that you are open enough to let the Spirit of God lead and guide you in some things. So at a difficult time in the life of people, a time when uncertainties was looming and the Lord demonstrated His goodness and His mercy, the people sat in darkness. They had seen the marvelous work of the Lord. So Matthew records something for us that I want us to see in chapter 14, 1 through 12. I'm not going to read that, but I'm going to walk down through it. John the Baptist had been beheaded, and Jesus has walked on water when he get a little further in chapter 14 to get His disciples out of trouble who had found themselves in a storm. When we get to chapter 14, verse 34, Jesus healed and made many well. And then we get over into chapter 15, Jesus has discussed with the religious leaders about people honoring Him with their lips and their hearts were far from Him. All of this is proceeding where I want to show us something in chapter 16. Blind, he talked to the leaders about the blind leading the blind and that they need to be careful about the teaching, the false teaching or the doctrine of the Pharisees and scribes. Then we come to chapter 16. Religious leaders came to Jesus, testing Jesus about, they wanted Him to show them a sign. And Jesus commanded His disciples to watch out for the false teachers or for the leaven of the scribes and the Pharisees. And the disciples were unsure what Jesus will talk about. And this is paramount as I look at where we are now. Jesus had been walking with them for almost 3 years. in walking with them, he had done a lot of teaching, a lot of miracles had transpired. And here in chapter 16, some 3 years later, he is ministering to them and they are struggling. They are looking at it still from a carnal perspective, and Jesus is talking about the things of God and the teaching, and they think that Jesus is simply talking about bread that they failed to take with them. And he reminded them how he fed the 5,000 and asked them, had they forgot it? Well, when we look at chapter 16, verse 18, and I will read that verse, and I pray that you are taking notes and go back in and take a look at this, because this is setting up what we're going to take a look at in John. In Matthew chapter 16, verse 18, these are the words, and I also say to you that you are Peter, and on this rock I will build my church, and the gates of Hades shall not prevail against it. What I want us to notice there, and we all know this, we have heard it time and time again, Jesus said he would build a church and the gates of hell would not prevail against it. So as we said in these trying times right now, the COVID-19 virus is not going to prevail against your church. Get that down in your spirit. Get that down in your soul. Wrestle with whatever is in front of you. Keep the faith with that word. If we suffer with him, suffer with that word within us, we shall be winners. Notice now in verse 19, Jesus went on to say, I will give the keys to the kingdom of heaven. And whatever you shall bind on earth shall be bound in heaven. And whatever you shall loose on earth shall be loosed in heaven. Notice now, Jesus said he would build, but he told Peter, I'm going to give you the keys. The key give us access to the power of heaven. The keys give us the authority, the ability to bind and loose things in heaven and earth. We have to understand where we are is just a testing of our faith. Whose report are we going to believe? Now notice, after Jesus spoke this in verse 20, he instructed them not to tell anyone. That is odd and unusual. He asked them, who do people say that I am? And they thought he was a prophet. Then he asked them, who do you say that I am? Peter said that thou art Christ, the Son of the living God. Now he tells them, don't tell anyone who I am or what I'm telling anyone about the fact that I'm Jesus. And in verse 21, from that time forth, Jesus began to show them that he must go to Jerusalem and suffer many things of the elders, the chief priests, the scribes, and be killed and rise again on the third day. Now for me, this is a revelation, because he told them, upon this rock I build my church and the gates of hell shall not prevail. This to me is the beginning and end in a narrative or in a teaching or promise that Jesus made to the disciples, the beginning and ending of building the church of God. In other words, when I read this, there were some things that Jesus spoke about that he's building the church, that he had to address and deal with issues in regards to his church being built. And it starts right there. From that time forth, he went on to show them. He went on to show them. He went on to show them that he had to suffer many things. He had to go to Jerusalem. He had to suffer many things of the elders, the chief priests, the scribes, and be killed. Notice now, Jesus had to address problems in the holy city. He had to address problems with leadership. He had to deal with the management issues of the people, those who were supposed to be holy, holy men of God. They had strayed away from God. Jesus had to deal with these spiritual leaders, the elders, the chief priests, the scribes, and the Pharisees, leaders who tried to keep the letter of the law, but they missed the spirit of the law. Watch this. Not only did Jesus have to address the problem of the holy city the problem dealing with leadership, he had to address problems of the people. People wanted to be healed. They wanted to be blessed, but they were fickle. They were immature. They just followed Jesus for the most part of just being blessed, just to get something. But he had to deal with these issues, these problems, in building his church, that the church could be a church that would the gates of hell would not prevail against it. And he had to show that how much he loved the church and the length and breadth of his love and the extent that he would go to save the people. And then another thing that he had to address and deal with, he had to deal with the issues with the disciples, men whom he had served to train, to be fishers of men, to set in order, to minister to the people. But oftentimes they failed to understand what he was saying regarding to the spiritual matter. So he had to deal with this. This is part of that building process. After 3 years, Jesus began to tell them he must suffer and be killed. What he would give and sacrifice for people. What he would give and sacrifice for the kingdom of God. He had to show them what he would do for the will of God and for what God has sent him forth to do. Remember now, the place, Jerusalem, is the holy city. It's the city of God. It's this sacred place, the place where people went to worship, to make sacrifices for their sin. And Jerusalem is the city where the temple of God was located. We know back in the day, the tabernacle was constructed by Moses, but it came through history that David envisioned to build a temple of the Lord, and he got everything in order, but his son Solomon constructed it, a place where God will come and rest and be with his people. David, God promised him that the offspring of David would always be on the throne of God. And this is where we get into the gospel account that Jesus Christ is part of that lineage, and he reigns as king and ruling in the holy city. Jerusalem is this holy place, but it is out of order. People are ignoring God. The people living in the city just want to get what they can get, and they weren't really fully being changed. And then the priests, those who were supposed to minister to the people of God, those who God had chosen, while the elders were those wise men selected, while the scribes were those who studied and prepared themselves to interpret the word of God, and the disciples were those who the Lord had called to follow him, he had to deal with these issues going on the inside of them. But somewhere along the way, the house of God changed from the house of prayer to a den of thieves. I know you remember that. So could it be where we're living now? It is the possibility that the city of God, the people of God, that's supposed to be sit on a hill and not be hid, has strayed from God, have lost their faith, or begin to be like the world. And we know the things of the world should not entice us and have more of an impact on us than the things of God. We know that the Lord went in, he had to kick people out of the temple because they changed the temple from a house of prayer to a house of merchandise. They had turned it into a business operation. Somewhere along the way, the city got messed up. The temple got messed up. The priest and those who charged the lead had got messed up. The people whom God loved forgot about him. They began just to go through the motion, do as they please. So as I think about the times of which we live now, it's dark and it's dismal. And what we don't want to forget, even in the midst of all of this going on, good news is right there, and his name was Jesus Christ. So it is with us. The people were far from God. As we had read in Matthew, they served God with their lips, but their hearts were far away. It's so odd and unusual were the people, they even killed John the Baptist. They didn't even know who Jesus was. Some thought that he was John the Baptist, who rose from the dead, and Elijah and Jeremiah, or even one of the old prophets. And then we leave the place, and we leave the people, and we leave the priests, and we get to the apostles, or to the prophets, chosen disciples of God. They were fickle, full of, failed to understand what God was trying to get over to them because they would be leading his church in the days to come. The people said on one occasion, praise God, but then on another occasion, they was talking about crucifying him. I believe this is where we are. We have come to a place in life where religious leaders, apostles and prophets, evangelists, pastors and teachers are seeking their own righteousness and forsaking the Lord. I'm trying to be careful here. And the reason that I want to be careful, we all got to take inspection of ourselves, take a look within ourselves and look at our intent. And are we faithful and are we committed to the things of God? Where people are seeking their own righteousness or the righteousness of God. When preachers are proclaiming the gospel, saying what people want to hear rather than what God is instructing them. So now they kind of give us a backdrop of talking about the good news. Could it be that all of this is going on, that we all need to be more attentive, and God is showing us something as from that time forward, he was showing his disciple the things he had to deal with, the ugliness and the evilness of men and what was going on in the temple and what was going on in the city, so bad that he would be killed, but he also brought the good news that he would rise in 3 days. Now, again, this good news is a part of what we are in life. In a time that we are traveling through the valley of the shadow of death and in darkness, there is light and there is life. The purpose of this Bible study is to turn our attention to the good news, the gospel that we believe in, to increase our faith in Jesus Christ. We have been on this journey of life for a long time. We have faced challenges before. We have experienced hardships before. But the current situation we face today, remaining at home, wearing masks, social distancing, our restriction on where we can go and the limitation on what we can do. This is, to my knowledge, the first time we have faced the unknown and the uncertainties that we face in life. No different than it was when I was talking about in Matthew. They just was unsure and not even recognizing that good news was right in that present. So it's critical now for believers to keep the faith, not stray from the good news or from the gospel, the good story about Jesus Christ. Oh, it's time for us to receive. The gospel is the power of God unto salvation to all who believe. The good news saved us. Good news, the gospel keeps us. This is why we must fight the good fight of faith. I believe, again, John mentioned to us during his presentation last week about our faith and the elevation that come. So now, John's writing in the gospel. And the reason I wanted to take a look at John's writing, we want to go to the very first chapter. John is writing primarily that the people might believe in Jesus Christ. This is why he put his writing, the gospel or the good news that he wanted the people to see. Now, all of the writings in the gospel took place after the death, burial, and resurrection. So they're not writing it from looking forward. They're writing it from a hindsight. So now he's writing and he's hoping and believing and praying that what he's putting in print will help people to believe in Jesus Christ. This is the good news that John brings to us. He's writing also to those who are lost, to unbelievers and to new believers, to philosophers and to theologians. John is trying to get this message out that Jesus is this good news. And the good news, God knows we can use some now, is of Jesus Christ. And then there's his second purpose for which he writes, and that is to refute all heresy that might arise from generation to generation. In other words, John argued that Jesus Christ is the very word of God, God himself. He want to put to any argument that there is no God. So he goes after that to make that clear. He wanted to dismantle any disbelief that denied that Jesus Christ was human, that he lived down here and he was tempted with everything as we are without sin. So he writes in such intensity and in such a way that he can convict people of that through his writing. He argues that Jesus Christ is the Word of God that became flesh, the very flesh which must be experienced. The Word of God, the Logos of God, is Christ, if we can get that down. Now look at this. Jews saw the Word as something more than a mere sound. They saw the Word of God as something active and existing. They saw the Word as power. While on the other hand, Greek saw the Word in more of a philosophical kind of way. In other words, they looked at the Word, the world, or looked at nature, and they saw everything in order. It was not chaotic. Everything was moving and grew together in an orderly fashion. Therefore, the Greeks saw behind the world is this great mind, this reason, this power that made and kept things together. They took John now took both expression of what the Jews thought about the Word and what the Greeks thought about the Word, and that's how he centered up his writing and brings it out in a way enable men to think and reason. In other words, when we hear about Word, Word gives light, it illuminates, and this is where the Greek looked at it, that behind Word is this creative mind, this awesome mind of God. So John took this now, and he began to pen his Word to us. So he tells us in the first chapter of John's Gospel, chapter number 1, let me get there, about the Word. He starts out, "In the beginning was the Word." So keep in mind, this Word he wants us to understand is this very essence of God. When we start speaking, it tells you what's on a person's mind. It tells you what's in a person's heart, how they feel. So he said the Word was with God and the Word was God. He was in the beginning with God. So he goes on to say that the Word, Jesus Christ, is light, he's life. God's very expression is being spoken through a man. So if we want to know and see and hear and understand what God is thinking, just look at Jesus. That is what he is trying to get over to the people that read his writing. The Word that is given unto us should anchor us. Jesus went through everything. He died. He rose again. Everything he said was true. He said, "I will never leave you nor forsake you." These are the things that we should hold on to and be committed to as we move forward in life. John goes on to say that this light was the light of men. The light shined in darkness, but the darkness comprehended it not. If we can kind of understand where we are now in the dismal time or in this dim time in the history, there is some good news. The light shine, but are we comprehending the light that's shining for us? When we look at this light was the true light, so John says in the writing. So why would John be led to write in verse 6 through 8? There was a man sent from God whose name was John, that this man came for witness and bear witness of the light, and all through him might believe. He was not the light, but he was sent to bear the light. So if you walk with me, I'm going to show you something. When he began with verse 1 and ended at verse 5, the light shined in darkness and the darkness comprehended it not. It looks more fluid that verse 9 would be night. That was the light that shined and give light to every man that came into the world. But he didn't do that. He inserts now verse 6 through 8, which seemed to take it out of context. Why now would he want to put verse 6 through 8 in there when he was talking about the light, and now all of a sudden he said that was a man sent from God? Well, one of the things that we might want to take note of, this man was sent from God. His name was John. Get that. This man, John, came for witness, to bear witness of the light. that all through him who believe. Okay, watch this. In verse 8, he acknowledged he was not the light, but was sent to bear witness of the light. All I'm trying to say, in times of darkness and despair, there has to be a witness for God. There has to be a witness of the light. So perhaps John writes now to insert here, there had to be a witness of the light, of the life of God, and his name was John. Because the people did not comprehend, there has to be a witness. This man was sent for God. I believe it's important that we understand for people to believe, there has to be a witness. Are we witnessing for the Lord in this time of darkness and despair and dismal moments that we're going through? Are we witnessing about the true light? Are we able to share and explain about the hope that we have and the good news that we have about this true life that we have, this word of God that became flesh? There has to be a witness. Please get that. Are we supposed to be a witness in this time we're in? I would say yes. A witness need for the world to believe. Get it? A witness is needed for the world to believe. What good is having word, man, nobody to testify about it? What good is having a God that we cannot share how awesome and great and grand he is? A witness is need for people to believe. For the place to turn to God or the city to turn to God, there need to be a witness. This is why I started out with Matthew. For the people to repent and understand the kingdom of God is at hand, and there must be a witness. For the temple of God to turn from the place where people have turned it into a business center and trying to promote their own sale, there has to be a witness. When people change the house of God from a house of prayer to a house of business instead of being a place of worship and praise, and where priests and teachers and evangelists are no longer sharing, there has to be a witness to the truth. Notice now John's testimony. When the Jews sent the priests and Levites out to him in verse number 19, and I'll go there. Now, this was a testimony of John when the Jews sent priests and Levites from Jerusalem. Remember, Jerusalem is jacked up. So now they send church leaders or religious leaders, and they came to John and they asked John, "Who are you?" Notice now, John confesses in verse 20, and did not deny and confess, "I am not the Christ." This is another important thing for those of us who are going to be witnesses of the Lord. So they went ahead and pressed him even more and said, "What then are you? Are you Elijah? Are you one of the prophets?" And he answered, "I'm not." He said, "Well, answer us, are you one of the prophets?" He answered in verse 21, "No." Then they said, "Who are you that we may give an answer to those who sent us? What do you say about yourself?" And this is what he said. He said, "I'm just a voice. I am the voice of one. I'm the voice of one. I'm the voice of one crying in the wilderness, making straight for the Lord." So now that's the second thing that I think that we as witnesses want to pick up on. If we are going to be witness for the Lord, we got to be reminded. Hear me, preachers and teachers and apostles. We must be reminded we are not the light. We are sent to bear witness of the light. We cannot rob God of his glory. We are sent to bear. We got to be like John. We got to confess that we're not the Christ. We got to confess that we're not the light. So when we press to identify who we are and why we're doing what we are called, we are just a voice crying in the wilderness. So there has to be a witness when there are dark times, dismal times, hurting times, when it looks like we have no place to go, nowhere to turn. There has to be somebody holding up the bloodstained banner. There has to be someone that's preaching and teaching truth. There has to be someone, a witness, who turned the people from their own ways back, put their attention and focus on the Lord. That's the good news that we have. We have this good news to share with others. And I pray that we will seize the time in which we're living and share with people the truth. We have been in hard times before, but isn't it wonderful that we can be where we are right now? I'm not too sure where I am on time, but this is a good word for me. We have the good news of Jesus Christ. We got to be witnesses to that good news. We got to share. We got to know that we are not Christ. We got to let folks know and confess that we are not the light. We just simply a voice crying in the wilderness. Let me read a couple of other verses. Let's drop down to verse number 25. Verse number 29 in chapter 1 of John's gospel. Notice now it says, the next day, John saw Jesus coming towards him and said, behold, the Lamb of God who taketh away the sins of the world. This is exciting to me. Watch this. This is he who I said, after me would come a man who is preferred before me, for he was before me. I do not know him. I'm going to stop right there. John has been witnessing for the Lord, but he says he don't know him. Right there in verse 31. How can that be? What is the writer, what is John the Apostle trying to tell us that John the Baptist is trying to convey? Since he'd been baptized and since he was pointing out, but here in verse number 31, it says, I did not know him, but that he should be revealed to Israel, therefore I came baptizing with water. So John and the Baptist and Jesus was cousin. So now if they're a cousin, you would think that he would have known Jesus. So is he really saying he don't know him in the sense of our understanding, or is he sharing with us that he did not know how awesome Jesus Christ was? And as he is beginning to share, he's now saying, I didn't know he was that grand. I didn't know he was that powerful. I did not know him. That is why I'm witnessing to you today. After all we've been through, I'm sure that we don't know the fullness of God and the power of his resurrection. So there need to be a witness. Secondly, we need to understand we just divorced. We're not the light and we're not Christ. And then thirdly, do we really know God in his fullness, or do we know only in part? So I pray that as we press our way, keep moving forward, that all of us will seek the Lord and inquire of him and get better understanding about what God is showing and getting us to understand about him. Even in those latter days, Jesus would test their faith. He would tell the disciples, I'm going to the other side. And then he would send them over and they get caught in a storm and he would walk out on the water. He would be in the boat with them and the storm got so bad they woke him up and he asked them, where's your faith? Could it be that our faith is being tested right now? Could it be that we're being challenged right now to see if we're going to hold on and fight the good fight of faith with the faith that we have? Or is it that we're fickle? We think we know, or we just going to give up and quit? But I declare unto you, we got new good news. He is the light. He is life. He is full of power and truth in his name in Jesus. The Bible from Genesis to Revelation is full of that light and that illumination and that light. So we can just hold on to it. I believe that we will be a better people for it. We're going to come out of this. If we believe and stay strong and be faithful, we are going to be blessed out of this. Always remember now that there are blessings and burdens. Remember that there is good in darkness. As we walk through the valley of the shadow of death, we shall not fear. So be strong in the Lord. Don't get so convicted on yourself that you know everything. Be careful, as the Lord told his disciples, about those Pharisees and the unleavened teaching that they do. Be leery of people that know everything that God's going to do and when he's going to do it and how he's going to do it. Be leery of people that's drawing attention to themselves rather than turning the attention to the Lord. It is a full-time job for me to keep myself in check. And in this time, my testimony to you is almost an hour by hour, day by day, of trying to get some understanding and not adjust and try to get so far ahead of God that I already know. This is why I wanted the gospel, the good news, to speak to you and to me rather than me to expound on what the verses are saying. I'm just sharing it with you, praying that you will go back and look at those verses, the first chapter of John's gospel. He writes that we might believe, and by writing, it is our prayer and hope that he will be convicted, to just keep empowering us, that we will be convinced that there's none like him. It is a wonderful time, even though it's stressful and dark and dim. We got to listen to all the leaders. We got to take all the information in. But the one that we want to put all of that before is God, and ask him to lead and direct us and show us the path in which we should take. And it's only what we do for Christ will last. So be encouraged. Put a smile on your face. If it's hard for you, get up and start praising about it, because the daylight's going to come in the morning. So I look forward that you guys will be challenged and do a little bit more for yourself during this time. Keep yourselves safe. We love you. We're praying for you. If you need anything, we can help any way, please. Text us, put it in the chat box, call the church, 540-288-9253. We are here to serve if there's anything that we can do at all. So we love you, and we will talk with you guys later.